morning, everybody.
Randy.
It is great to have you here this morning. We are going to get started, so if you want to come up, find a place to sit, stand. Let's just turn our attention to Jesus. Lord, we love you. And we praise you. And we just want to get our focus and our attention right now on you, our King of Kings and our Lord of Lords. Lord, where there's been any distractions through this week or things that are weighing heavy on our souls, Lord, we just lay those at the foot of the cross right now because you have the solutions for them, and the best thing we can do is worship you. And so we give you our full attention so that we can praise you. Amen.
Good morning, church. Almost forgot my first song. Just kidding. No, I'm sorry. Well, Happy New Year. It's been amazing so far, and it's going to be amazing. God is so much in store for us. Yeah. All right. Hi, Randy. Let's do this. Hey, hey. Let's sing together, Holy, Holy.
And holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around. We sing it again, holy. Oh, this new year, I put my trust on you, God. I put my trust on you. I put my trust on you. Just declare it. Just sing it out. We put our trust. We put our trust on you. We fix our eyes. We fix our eyes on you, Jesus. I will build. And I will live my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. And I will put my trust in you. Who brings it? chaos back into order. Who leads the orphan, a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing. You've done for me, God. I will sing all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. I will sing, I will sing of all you've done for me, God. Yeah. I will sing for me. All that you've done for me.
Let's sing worthy.
Yeah, worthy.
I think that's worth shouting about. Our God is alive. Woo! Yeah. Yeah, he's conquered the grave.
the world before the beginning. One with God, the Lord knows how. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ.
Let me sing it again.
You were the word. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name. there is power in the name of Jesus. 'Cause there is power in the name of Jesus. We sing his name. 'Cause there is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. You break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. We sing it again. There is power. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Break every chain. Here. There is power in the name of Jesus. Lift it up. There is power in the name of Jesus. 'Cause there is power in the name of Jesus. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
In our love, so we pour out our praise.
Holy Spirit, just continue to work in our hearts and our lives as you are doing already this morning, just bringing your peace. You feel His peace here? We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Any circumstances in your life that feel hopeless at this moment in time, or areas that you've been struggling with, just feel this first gathering of 2020, if there's things that you want to leave behind, just lay them at the foot of the cross right now, because as we've declared that the name of Jesus is powerful. You know, we don't have the ability in ourselves to change ourselves, but we do have the Holy Spirit. We do have the power of the name of Jesus. And so, Holy Spirit, would you bring to mind things you want us to leave behind? Just symbolically lay them at the foot of the cross. What I'm going to ask you to do is just the people around you, just, you know, we're only going to take 2 minutes to do this because then we're going to do communion. I just want you to bless, you know, bless the people to your right and left. Remind them that they are a new creation in Christ, that the old is gone and the new is here. So just take that moment to bless one another. Wonderful. Well, we have got four stations set up so we can do communion together today. And I just think it's a wonderful way we get to start the year, starting it together and having communion with our Lord. And so what we're doing when we have communion is that we are recognizing the body and the blood of Jesus. We're remembering Jesus' death, the fact that his body was broken for us. You know, that his body was broken, that it says in Scripture that by his stripes we are healed. You know, that there's, we believe, you know, that there's significance to us having communion. And the grape juice representing the blood of Jesus, that blood that was poured out, that sanctifies you, makes you holy, makes you clean, you know, that conquers sin and death. It's just an incredible thing. And so let's just together, you know, I'm not going to lead us all in it. I just explained it. Just grab some juice and some bread. And just you and Jesus. You and Jesus. If you want to gather with a couple of people around you, you can do that too. It's up to you. But if you just want to have an intimate moment of God, of communion with him, remembering his body broken and his blood shed for you, let's do that together. What a powerful way for us to begin 2020 together. Not only a new year, but a new decade. And while they're just numbers at the end of the day on a calendar, there's always, when, especially the change of a decade, it gets us thinking about new beginnings and new things happening. I want to open up the mic for, we can do it for 10 minutes here, for testimonies or prophetic words or anything to come and to encourage the community. So if you've got a word, again, just keep it short so that we can, you know, accommodate the different people coming up. Because I've got 10 minutes total that we can do that. Okay?
Good morning, Chase. I am looking for Justin. Anyway, I can't see him, but I have a testimony. And this testimony, for those who were here, and you remember, it's been quite a few months when Justin stood up here on a Sunday and he gave a prophecy and prayed at the same time. He said that he was praying for somebody who had a cyst on their face. And when he said that, for those that have been seeing me, I think you remember I had a bump which was sticking out for quite a few months now on my face. When he said that, he didn't call people to stand up or to come up here. He just said, touch your face and touch that bump, and I'll pray for you. And the Lord is saying, I have healed you. I just took it and I ran with it. Months and months went by, and that bump kept on growing and growing. And then I went to the doctors and I did an ultrasound, a CT scan. Everything was negative. Nothing was showing. And they kept on saying, this is a very complicated cyst. So now they scheduled me to go and see a head and neck bone specialist so he can take it out. So I'm still waiting for that appointment. And then all of a sudden, beginning of December, this thing just started disappearing on its own. And as you can see, I don't think any of you can see it anymore on my face. So I want to say to somebody, I want to encourage somebody, it is very important when the Lord drops a word to take it and run with it. It's also important and very key not to keep going, you know. Every time there's, you know, people call for healing, you jump and go there. It's like you're doubting God. If you have taken it the first time, just take it and run with it. Amen.
Awesome. I think I have a prophetic word. I don't know who this is for, so I'm just going to call out certain things and see if it relates to you, okay? So I believe that there's someone here who has been very conscious about their inner life, about their spiritual life, and about their character, and thinking very much about transformation, inner transformation, and what the Lord has placed on their heart is to soak, bring about, to allow the Holy Spirit to transform and overcome certain areas in your life through soaking in rest and soaking. And what you've experienced is, through that soaking, a heightened sense of perceiving God's voice. Is there anyone who can relate to this? Oh, so many. Okay. Well, I'm not going to go through this list. Well, in that case, I'm not going to prophesy over each one of you. Just, Father, we'll just say a general prayer, okay, for these friends. Father, we just thank you for these people. Could you actually stand up, please? We just thank you for your people who have responded not only to your voice in particular, but to the overall anointing and direction that has been released in this church in Jesus' name. Thank you for the message of transformation. Thank you that this church is honoring and partnering with the Holy Spirit in a seeking transformation, and that, Father, you are saying that it is easy. That is through rest in you. So, Father, we just pray for these people. We bless them for greater transformation, greater sensitivity to your Spirit. In Jesus' name, we thank you for greater, we just pray for greater, a greater anointing of rest and soaking during our times of worship. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi, I had the privilege of going to Open Heavens to start the New Year's. That was awesome. And it's been an awesome week because it's been really deep and heavy, and the Lord guided me every day to different things. But one day I was at Square One and got lost. I've been there many times, and I got lost. I was going around 3 hours, couldn't find my car. I said, Lord, what's going on here? And I gave tracks on benches and stuff. So I don't know why you had me here. I was going there to find somebody, and there wasn't a meeting. It was a prophetic word over the phone. So I said, oh, well, whatever. I'm here for a reason. I might as well go around and give tracks away. And on my way, I finally found my car, and the Lord spoke to me and said, you haven't eaten, go eat your blueberries. So I went and sat down and ate the blueberries. And there was a couple beside me, and they were homeless with a new baby, 2 months old. And I was able to minister into their lives. And then a friend of mine said, I have something for your computer at 5. And I was talking to them between 3 and 5, went to McDonald's a whole bit later. And him and I spent hours ministering to this couple. So I'm not good with names, but the Lord knows their names if you could pray for them. And their baby, they were put out on the street because the parents were prejudiced against the black husband. So, and she's white. So it's so sad. And there's a 2-month-old baby just... like they're trying to survive. So anyways, God's good. It was a divine appointment. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, Lord, we just lift that family up to you. Lord, you know what's going on in their life. You know all the different circumstances that we don't know. And we just pray, God, most importantly, they would know you. Thank you that you'd send people into their lives and that they would, Lord, every one of their needs would be met and that they would be on a path of life and prosperity. Amen.
Good morning. The pastor's been encouraging us for a long time to constantly speaking about Jesus. That everywhere we go, that needs to be what we're doing with our lives. And I've been hearing that message over and over again. And even as the word came this morning, I've been spending more and more time in the word. And I've been reviewing words that I remember my parents having us memorize as children that were about our relationship with Jesus. And so this week, I was able to lead my neighbor to Christ. We visit fairly regularly. He does things for me when I'm away in my apartment and things, and he's put up a few things for me and stuff. So he had to bring some keys back to me, and he always sits and visits, and we talked, and God just took over the conversation. Just took it over. So he was going to be here this morning, but his elderly mother isn't very well. So I'm just thrilled that this is happening in our midst, that God is doing this. And you know, a few weeks ago I spoke about a message about the heart. And this morning we sang about asking for the heart of God in us. And that overwhelmed me. Can you imagine God, the creator of the universe, that we can have his heart in us? And we also sang about having his breath in our lungs. God is powerful and he's in us. It's overwhelming. It just gives me goosebumps. God bless.
Awesome. Thank you so much. I got time for one more. Troy and Liberty.
Good morning. Okay, so this Christmas, it's a time, God said it's a time of healing. So in our family, there was a lot of broken relationships between my dad and 5 children. So out of the 5, he was speaking to only one. Oh, he's speaking to one. However, God in the summer spoke to me and said, you need to go and mend with your father. So my dad being a Lebanese father is very... anyway, so I said, okay, Lord, I need you to go before me. And I prayed all the way down to Windsor, and he did. God showed up. That's the power of prayer for one. And he walked in before, and it was like nothing had happened. There wasn't really much of a strain between my dad and I. There was more. The mending was between my husband and my dad, which was a long time ago. But however, it's a long story. So to make it quick, there was still my sister and my dad, which is the older sister, and that was a very strained relationship. Something happened between the two of them where he said, I'll never forgive her. Just, he's very stubborn, very... old ways. And I said this year, I said God put on her heart, and when I went forward, she says, okay, I think it's time. So we prayed, and we prayed for about 15 minutes, and she was a little bit nervous, but I said, okay, it's time to do this, including my older brother. So we prayed before we went, and she was a little nervous, and when we went in, my dad said, how many times do I have to forgive? And I said, Jesus said 70 times 70, Dad, and you just keep forgiving. And that's If you want forgiveness, then you have to forgive. And he just looked at me, and it was as if the Holy Spirit just it hovered over the house. And that is the power of God in prayer. And he said, when you pray and you ask me to go before you, he does. If it's in his will, and relationship is in his will, because that's his heart. And he went before us, and it was as if this Christmas he went from having 4 children out of the 5, last year was 1, to having 4. So there's 1 more. And that is the mending of hearts. That's God's heart. So my message is, never stop praying. Pray and wait. Wait on the Lord. He'll go before you.
I'm out of time. I'm sorry. I have to move on. Graham.
Good morning. Just want to take a moment and welcome anyone who's visiting with us this morning. You are so welcome, and we are thankful you were here with us today. We're so thankful. Please, before you leave today, please visit the welcome desk at the back. Sunette, one of our administrators, will be happy to chat with you and get you connected here and help us get to know you more. So wanted to also, to all newcomers, not just today, but if you haven't had a chance to be a part of the newcomers lunch, the welcome lunch, we would like to invite you. So if you haven't been a part of that and you've been visiting us or been a part with us for a few months, that is actually being held on Sunday the 12th. So next Sunday the 12th at 12:30 at not here, but at 6600 Falconer Drive, which is our facility as a church facility. It's at 6600 Falconer Drive. So please join us on that date. So at this time, I'd now like to invite the ushers, if you can get the baskets ready. I'm just going to share a few things about how you can give to Lifehouse Church. So there's a number of ways you can give. You can give on PushPay. We have a QR code if you want to put that up on the screen as well. If you want to point your camera to the QR code, that'll take you right to the app, which will allow you to give online as well on our website. You can also give checks and cash into the envelopes at the end of your aisles. And the other thing you can do is also, if you have any prayer requests, you're welcome to write down any prayer requests for yourself or for someone on your heart. You can write that down. We have a prayer team that meets once a week to specifically pray for those cards and what's shared on those cards. So along with the offering this morning, something I wanted to share is, if you can put up the next slide, I had a sense from God this morning that we really need to declare new things over our lives and over this community and over each one of us this morning. And declarations tend to be a really wonderful thing to do corporately as a community. We haven't done this in a while. We used to do this a lot. We used to do this almost every week where we came together and just corporately declare things over ourselves. And there's something unique and powerful when you speak it out into the atmosphere. God can really move as you declare it openly. So what I'd like to do is all of us say this together. So we're going to do this together. I'm going to read it to you. I don't have it memorized, so I'm going to turn around. And we're going to speak out this together, okay, everything. So, and it's going to be not just this, but the next slide as well. Okay, so 1, 2, 3. We ask that we'll have more finances and resources to keep our personal and family needs and to give to others. Should be more. Lord, release checks in the mail, raises and bonuses, favorable settlements, financial windfalls and surprises, found money, debts paid off, increased income, decreased expenses, blessing and increase. Help us to always submit ourselves, our finances, business, jobs, and careers to you. Remain pure in heart and motive. Be faithful and good stewards of our finances. Be radically generous. Be humble. Be gracious. I think that's it. Amen. Amen. So praise God. Praise God for that. That's powerful. Whew. Okay. So Father, just thank you, Lord, for this declaration over each one life, Lord. We just thank you that these things spoken are not just words, but they are your will for each one life here, Lord, in Jesus' name. So as we give this morning, Lord, we just pray a blessing over our finances and everything that you're going to use for your kingdom, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Just two more quick announcements before I hand it over to James. I wanted to just mention that there is an open administration role available right now. You can apply for the administration role here at Lifehouse Church. It's a one-year term contract with the community. You can apply until the end of February for that role because our lovely Sunette is going on maternity leave, which we're all very excited about. So, and I'm sure a lot of us know that. So we're excited for that. So you're welcome to apply for that position. And the other thing I wanted to mention was One Worship, which is happening in like 2.5 weeks on January 24th. This is an awesome time to come together as a community with other church communities in our vicinity. And we meet at Red Hill Church. If you want more information about this, it's on the weekly email that you get. And if you want more information from Sunette or one of the leaders here, we'd be happy to talk to you about this. Again, it's January 24th at 7 p.m. at Red Hill Church. Okay.
Well done, Graham. Great job. I'm going to, one more thing that I want you to save the date for. If you can save the weekend, the last weekend of February. So the last weekend of February, I think it's like the 27th, 28th, or the 28th, 29th, and the 1st of March. We have someone coming in to minister that weekend, talking about the prophetic and spiritual mothers and fathers and the importance of that. And so there's going to be a number of dates, actually, that are some key dates for us this year. We'll actually get the list of them to you in the next week or so. But I want you, because that one is the closest, I want you to be able to get that aside in your calendars. We'll do a Friday night and a Saturday morning session with the people coming in. They are people that are connected to me through the Bethel Leaders Network. They lead a church in Fort Worth, Texas, and they minister around the United States and around the world, specifically in the prophetic and in spiritual, raising up spiritual mothers and fathers. Basically, people that can disciple others. So it's going to be a really key time for us as a community. More details on that one will be out shortly. Well, we get today, we're finishing off a series that we've been preaching on for more than a year on our core values. And this is the last one of them. We'll be finishing this up in the beginning of February. And this is that we have hope in a glorious church. And I think it's a wonderful way for us not only to finish this series, but to start this year. Because what we speak on is what this year we're going to be really putting into the community and helping us live and become that glorious church that we're meant to be. You know, and we are only part of the church. We're part of the body of Christ, but we are part of that body, and so we need to reflect God's glory in everything it is that we do. And so the specific one we're going to be speaking, or specific point of hope in a glorious church that we're going to talk on this morning, is that we are the bride of Christ, and that we are going to, as the bride of Christ, successfully fulfill the Great Commission. You know, my notes are playing games with me up here, so they are. I don't have the exact thing that is, it is up there on your screen. But the heart of this is that the church isn't defeated. The church is powerful because of Jesus. Right? We are his bride. He is the one that by his body broken for us, his blood shed for us, it's him that's made us clean. It's him that empowers us. And it's all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to the devil. Is that what it says? No, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to Jesus. Matthew 28, verses 18 to 20. Right? All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to Jesus. And so his commission to his disciples, which is commission to us, his commission to his church is therefore to go and make disciples of all nations. And so this is our commission as his glorious church. We're going to be reading from Ephesians today. I want to take us on a journey through Ephesians because it talks so well about this. There we go. So again, now that I've got my notes here, the church is the bride of Christ, and she will successfully fulfill his great commission to make disciples of all nations, which means the nations will experience transformation. The Lord's Prayer, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Our role is to fulfill the Great Commission. It's to bring heaven to earth. It's to transform society. The church is glorious, and it's been God's intent, and we're going to read it in Ephesians, that it's through his church, the church of Jesus Christ, not just the church of Lifehouse, the church, every person that believes and is surrendered to Jesus, that is a disciple of Jesus, and that Jesus is the Lord of their lives, through his church, this great commission is going to be fulfilled. That the nations will be transformed. And we need to see that that's our role. And understand that it's not a role we fulfill in our own strength, in our own ability. We actually do not have the strength. We actually do not have the ability to do it. But we do have the power, the choice, to surrender our will to his will and let him work through our lives to bring transformation. Amen? This topic, I could spend 6 months preaching on because it gets really, this comes down to what, you know, in theological terms is eschatology, which is your view of the end times. And there's a number of different ones. In North America, a really popular one based on someone's novel, Hal Lindsey, is this concept of the rapture and that the Christians are all going to disappear and we're going to be caught up in heaven and there's, you know, and then all these terrible things are going to happen. It's the opposite view of what we're talking about today. And so we do not have time in these 4 weeks that we're talking on this theory to go into all into the depth of eschatology. I'm going to talk a little bit about it just to give us, but if it's something you are interested in, you're like, I really need to understand this and I want to get my head around this, there is lots of resources I can give you to really understand eschatology in depth. But the thing that I want us to grasp with this is that our hope is not in our rapture. Our hope is not in our disappearing. Our hope is in our transformation of the world. Okay? And this is so important. It's so important. Because the difference of this is when the mentality, when we're just waiting to be raptured, is that we are just, you know, huddled down, society's falling apart around us, but there's this little remnant of the church that's being protected and that eventually is going to be rescued. And it takes our thinking. It's amazing, interesting. As the more popular that view became in North America, the least effective the church became. We disengaged from society, we stopped transforming from society, and the church just became this little holy huddle that stopped transforming the world and was just waiting. And so right now, you'll hear a lot of stuff. And if you look any North American Christian TV, you know, and this it's gone from North America out to the world, this thing, so you hear it all over the place. You'll hear right now, right? I mean, Donald Trump, attacks Iran, and immediately it's, oh, this is the World War III, it's the end of the world, the end times, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, all this is about to happen right now. Now, Jesus told us that we will not know, right? And again, this becomes a very, very long explained topic. The basic of it is that Jesus gave his church a mission. He gave us a mission. And regardless, they thought they were living in the end times in Paul's day. Okay? They thought they were. And even in that, they were given a mission. And their mission, Paul never wrote. You know, the disciples did not write to the church who that they believed they're living in the end times, withdraw from society, be a little holy huddle, and wait for Jesus to come back. What he did do was teach the church that they were to go out and transform the world. You know, that they were to be the salt and the light. And we're not just to be a light on a Sunday morning. We're actually, it's here that we get the fuel that we need to go out and be a light in the world through the rest of the 22, or however many, I can't do the math, 22 hours in the day on Sunday and the other 6 days of the week. Right? That is what it's all about. It's about us having hope that Jesus really will work through your life to transform society. It means everywhere you go, it means in your workplace, you are a light that is there to transform. In your neighborhood, you are there as a light to transform. In your school, you are there as a light to transform. God's glory, His grace, it works through you to affect everything around you. Just like we've talked a number of times through this series, that, you know, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, based on their theology, ran from the lepers. They ran from those from sin. They separated themselves from them to keep them holy. Jesus came as holy and washed them clean. He went to the lepers and transformed them. He went to the sinners to transform them. Right? And so, this glorious mission of the Great Commission is for us to go into the world and bring transformation. To bring transformation. Yeah? Is there an end times? Absolutely. Is Jesus returning? 100% He is returning. Will there be a final judgment? Yes, there will. So when you hear me going, you know, talking about us not having a holy huddle waiting for the rapture, we are waiting for the second coming of Christ. And the second coming of Christ happens, there will be a final judgment. There will be a separation. There will be a new, according to Scripture, a new heaven and a new earth. A new heaven and a new earth. A final transformed world. A final transformed world where Satan no longer has any power, no longer, you know, is no longer affecting people's life. The beautiful thing in Scripture from beginning to end is we start in the Garden of Eden and we start in this new Garden of Eden, which they refer to as the New Jerusalem. I want to encourage you, especially in these days, do not get caught up. I was starting to go there and I got distracted. Don't get caught up by everything going on in the Middle East. If you really want to understand eschatology, it has very little to do with what's being presented to you by the media. Again, it's a big topic that I've spent hours and days and months reading on. It's not something I can try to communicate to you in a 20-minute preach. But if you want to understand this, happy to point you in the directions. We actually have someone coming into the church in March who has written an entire book on Revelations. He's co-authored one of the most respected commentaries on the book of Revelations today. And God made a connection with him with us. You know, and so not, you know, it's not, he can explain every possible theory and why. You know, why these theories, where they came from, what's wrong with them, and why, you know, why we can accept certain ones. Sorry, Siri started talking to me up here. You know, and it's really important. These things are important. At the end of the day, you know, I say this because our goal is not to become experts on the book of Revelations, right? Our goal is to be people transformed by Jesus. Our goal isn't to become experts on the end times, right? Our goal is to be transformed, new creations in Jesus. Right? That is why we are here. It's what we're doing. You know, and unfortunately, it's because we have a world where there's tons of information, but not a lot of wisdom or knowledge. Right? That's a reality. And so we accept different things being brought to us, but they require significant study. You know, they require some of these things that these theories that people present, if we don't understand what's being presented to us, we accept things that are not true. It is very important for us in this, let's focus on Jesus. Let's focus on what he taught. Let's focus on being his glorious church, his absolutely glorious church in this world. Not waiting to be rescued, but transforming society and transforming this planet so that on the day that Jesus returns, he finds his bride in its glorious state, you know, doing what he commissioned us to do. Amen? So, with all that, let's turn to Ephesians 3, verse 10. And Ephesians is amazing. It's an incredible book. The part of Ephesians that we're looking at, Paul has just been talking about the fact that there's this new church being formed with Jews and Gentiles. That the mystery, one of them, he talks just in the few verses before that about this mystery, the administration of what Christ has done. He goes, what that mystery is that the Gentiles are saved as well. That it is that now both the Jews that believed in Jesus and Gentiles that believed in Jesus, anyone that wasn't a Jew by birth, they're all united in this new body, the church, this new body of Christ. And so it's from here, he talks about and writes about the power of the church and how it's supposed to function and how we're this glorious church. So we're starting in verse 10, and Paul writes here, he says that his intent, his being Jesus, his intent was that now through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to his eternal purposes that he accomplished in Christ Jesus, our Lord. In him and through him, in him and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. Incredible, right? His intent was now through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. So it was God's intent was that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God would be made known. Powerful. Through you. Through the church, through our lives, through our walking with Jesus, through our transformation by Jesus, that what the church should be, should speak and testify to all those around us, Jesus. Jesus. And looking at our lives and looking at how we are and looking at our families and looking at our character, it should speak Jesus. And looking at the power, not only power in terms of signs, wonders, and miracles, but the power to break the chains of sin, the power to transform character, to transform hearts. That is what the church is for. That's what it's for. It says in verse 12, in him and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. Paul then says, I ask you therefore not to be discouraged because of my suffering for you, which is your glory. He says that because he's writing this letter from prison, where he's been in prison for testifying about Jesus. And he says then, in his letter to the Ephesians, he says, for this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. Why does he say that? Just a little aside. So it's not just, well, we're the children of Abraham. It's like, no, it's no longer about being children of Abraham. It's about being children of God. Children of the Father. And Jews and Gentiles united in one new church. He says, I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is work within us. To him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. The church glorifies God. We glorify God in everything we do, in everything that we are, in everything about us. We are to bring glory to him. Through our own power? No. We've just read. It's through Jesus. It's through his power. It's through the immeasurable power that is immeasurably more than anything we could ask or imagine. In other of his letters, he talks about the same power that raised Christ Jesus from the dead. Why is this important? Because you don't have to be transformed by your own willpower. You actually can't be. Our transformation, we become the glorious bride of Christ in our willingness to surrender our will to him. Your will is your decision-making center of your soul, of your body. Your will is what makes you choose. What do I choose this or do I choose that? Do I go this way? Do I go that way? That is an exercise of your will. And our wills is where we go, I will surrender my will. I'll surrender my willing, my ability to do things on my own, and my give that to God. That means I can't change myself. You know, if you ever tried to bring about, you know, those areas of our life that we prayed for this morning, right? I said, if there's things that you want to leave behind, that you leave at the cross. I can imagine things that you brought to mind were things that maybe for years you've been wanting to change. You don't want them in your life, but like it says in Romans, we do the things that we don't want to do. Right? That we have these things in our life or circumstances that it doesn't matter how much willpower we try to apply to them, we aren't able to transform. And it's those things that we need to lay at the foot of the cross and thank Jesus. Lord, thank you that you've set me free from this. It has no power over me. Thank you that you've set me free. And the accuser comes and the devil comes and goes, it does have power over you because you did this, or that circumstance, or that person's making you mad, or that this person thing's making you do this, or that thing's making you do this. And you go, Lord Jesus, thank you that you have set me free. Thank you that you set me free. That person has no power over me. That feeling has no power over me. That addiction has no power over me because your name broke every chain. You broke every chain. And this is how we become glorious. We become glorious by our surrender to our faith in him, that what he did is more powerful than any addiction, any habit, any thought, any circumstance, any character default. And we can give them to him and he will transform us. He will transform us. He will transform us. He brings a transformation. Ephesians 4, verses 11 to 16, it says, so Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and the teachers to equip his people for works of service so the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. What is the whole measure of the fullness of Christ? It is when we reflect the character and the power of Christ in everything we are, in everything we do. That is the full measure of Christ. The full measure of Christ is your life, your character being transformed, your soul. It's a whole teaching that we'll get into a little bit later this year, you know, about will, heart, soul, spirit. But for the purposes of this, your soul is basically the part of you that encompasses your will, your heart, your emotions, your feelings. It talks about us not forfeiting our souls. It talks about our souls being saved. Your soul is what makes you you. And our souls are formed by every little choice and every little decision we make. When we lie, we take a little thing out of our soul. when we repent of that lie, we heal our soul. Every decision and choice. Again, we don't have the power to transform our souls in the sense to make them like Christ, but he does. What we have the power to do is choose to be Christ-like in our behavior. And when we find ourselves behaving in ways that are inconsistent with that, changing it. Why? Because we've got a mission and a world that needs to be transformed. And when they look at the church right now, they go, your lives are just as messed up as ours. There's no truth in what you're saying. And if we can't allow Christ to transform our lives, no amount of preaching, no amount of power, no amount of testifying is going to affect this world, because they just look and go, I look at you and you're telling me Jesus, but you're not transformed. His church is glorious. We're meant to be glorious. And this for us, we're meant to be a holy set apart people. A holy set apart people. Again, this is not saying this to you so you can beat yourself up and go, I got to try harder. I've got to be more. I'm saying it to you so you can invite God into the areas of your life that need transformation. Because it's not by your strength, it's by his spirit that we are transformed. It's by us going to him and allowing him into our lives, and he transforms us. He transforms us. He does the work. Right? And he will always, if we go, well, I'm inviting God in and it's not changing, well, the problem is truly not on God's side. It's really not that he's not changing you. The thing is, go, Lord, where am I holding on to this thing? You know, and sometimes it's a process. Sometimes it's instantaneous. But the more we invite him in, the more we get changed and the more glorious we become. And then our lives speak. You know, and the power flows. Our lives speak. It's so important. It says in verse 14, then we'll no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves, blown here and there by every wind of teaching, and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. I say this boldly, but this thing about not being blown here and there by every wind of teaching, I realize I'm only giving this little teaser thing on the rapture thing, and I do it to stir in you that if you believe in that theology, like, to really study, to really understand, because you can't hold on to Jesus and hold on to that theology. You can't fully understand who Jesus is and believe that theology as it is. But if we don't know Jesus, then we can be blown here and there by all kinds of winds of teaching. If we don't know who he is, we can be blown all over the place. And the church is blown all over the place. There was a time in my life I was blown all over the place by different things. You know, and it's these, when we know Jesus, when we've become to the fullness of him, this is not perfection. It's about his character being constantly, continually formed. You know, that we won't be blown all over the place by every wind of teaching. But we become mature. And he becomes our head, and we're surrendered to him. It says, from him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Again, apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, evangelists were not given to do the work of Christ. They were given to build you up so you can. For too long, the church has relied on big names, you know, and exalted people, but not empowered, not lived in empowered lives. It's not here ever about me being on a pedestal or anyone else being on a pedestal. It's about all of us together building up, encouraging one another, and going out and transforming the world. I could have the greatest preaching gift in the world, which I don't, but if I did and I could fill stadiums, you know, great, but what effect? To what effect? Because at the end of the day, Christianity is not lived out by an event, and it's not lived out. Making a decision for Jesus can be undone. You know, you hear of the people, I mean, Reinhold Bonnke, who had an incredible gift, just honored with a memorial service, incredible man. God used him so powerfully. But even for them, you know, of all the people who would give their life to Jesus, they could, you know, maybe 6% of the people that gave their life to Jesus actually walked that out. You know, that became real. And it's not about people making, you know, giving their life to Jesus in a meeting. It's about becoming disciples of Jesus and our life being transformed. Disciples. And big names and stadiums do not make disciples. They may be a catalyst for a decision. I'm not saying they're bad. But without an empowered church, it doesn't matter what happens there because the seeds all fall on ground and can't grow them. We need to be that glorious church because we all need to be able to disciple people to fulfill this great commission. This city's transformed when every one of us feels empowered and feels ready to run. The section between Ephesians 4:17 and 5:9 is so important, but it's already 12 o'clock, so I'm not going to go into it in depth. You all have Bibles, read it. Seriously, it's a great exercise in reading it, right? If you don't have a Bible, you have access to one online. If you don't have access to one online, come and ask us. We'll give you a Bible. Because we've got to be reading our Bibles. But we've got to not just read them. We've got to study them. We've got to understand them. Here, Paul says, I'll just read verse 17. He says, so I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking, for they are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their heart. In verse 19, having lost all sensitivity, they've given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. Sadly, so many churches you can go into around the world, and that would be the description of the church. And Paul writes this warning to the Ephesians where he talks about the fact, he starts off in talking in the letter to the Ephesians, talking about the fact that they've been chosen and that they have been purified by Jesus. And he warns them in this section of the letter. Says, look, you are this new creation, so don't live like the world does. You mustn't live that way anymore. It's totally inconsistent with who we are in Christ. And now, for all of us, we can go through that list and might be able to pick things off that still affect us. You can go through the Galatians and find the things that are of the flesh and pick things off that still affect you. And it's those things that we need to go, Lord, come in and heal my soul. Come in and heal my soul because I'm not meant to live like this anymore. These things are not meant to be here. They do not belong. They have no place. They have no place. This is not who I am. And to be that glorious church and transform society, we cannot excuse those things in our life. But we've got to be a loving community where it's fine for us to confess our sins. And what we find when we confess our sins isn't people going, oh, you're dangerous, stay away from me. But we go, brother, sister, let me pray for you. You know, it says in James about confessing your sins to one another. I think it's in James. I might be misquoting, my apologies. And then it goes on and says, but watch out so that you don't fall into sin. And we so often interpret that as, I got to be careful because I might get infected by that person's sin. That's not what it's saying. It's saying don't fall into judgment of the person. That's the sin, right? The sin is when we start judging one another. You know, a safe, holy, Jesus-centered, Jesus-focused community, it doesn't make room for sin in the sense of excuse it, but it makes space for confession and healing, repentance and change. Amen? Amen. So I'm going to skip this section just to bring us to a close. I'd highly encourage you to read that, though. Ephesians 5, verse 25 to 27. It says, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. Holy and blameless. That's how Christ sees us. Holy and blameless. We've been washed. We've been made clean. Christ gave himself up for us so that we would be that radiant bride. You are that radiant bride already. Just scrape off the mud so you can shine. Amen? And that's what we do. We go to God and we allow him. It's about us laying down our agendas. You know, this is not about, the world is not looking for personal ministries. It's not waiting for the sun or the one person or that to rise. We all have ministry. You know, it's about us just going out and being Christians. That's what it's looking for. It's not looking for James Colgan ministries or Adam and Lukey ministries or all the other things, all the other stuff that isn't actually anywhere that's biblical or part of the church. It's looking for a church, a people, a family, people that actually know Jesus and are going, I have a life of joy and peace. I have a life where I'm not living by the standards of the world and chasing after the things of the world. My life is one of joy and peace and love. Doesn't mean that people won't be used of God to go and equip. I'm not saying that. So please, don't read into things I'm not saying. It's this business mentality that we can get into. It's like, you know, I need my little ministry franchise. No, it's looking for family. 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 People loving one another. The power of God working through them. Churches being established. Churches being planted. Paul went and created families. He didn't go to a place, speak a message, and leave. He went to a place, established churches, gathered a group of people, put leaders in place, did all these different things so that family could grow. And then he kept coming back and visiting and writing and encouraging so that those families would become that beautiful, amazing, glorious bride of Christ. In his last bit of that letter, he says, just talking about the armor of God, he says, finally be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. And then he goes on to describe salvation and the different parts of the armor. We stand firm against the devil's schemes by remembering who we are in Jesus, that we are holy and blameless. We're that radiant church, and that things that are not of, have no part or place in our lives. And we stop making excuses. We transform. We love. We honor. We care for. We help each other. And we build each other up to be that glorious, radiant church so that this great commission is fulfilled. It's time for the church to take its rightful place in society again. Amen. Wonderful. Well, Lord, I just bless. I can't hand it over to anyone because I'm leading the meeting as well. So, Lord, I just bless everyone here. Lord, bless their souls. And let your peace dwell firmly in each and every one of us. In each and every one of us. That we'd hold firm. That we'd allow you to transform and we would be those radiant, joy-filled people that you died to create. Thank you that you've washed us clean, that we're your beautiful bride, and that you, Lord, are united with us and working through us to bring your kingdom to this world. Amen. Amen. Have a wonderful week. The ministry team is here at the side to pray for you.